Now, coming to the next topic, that is advantages and disadvantages of ROI. So ROI is a very easy tool to calculate. Might just calculate returns, controllable returns divided by controllable capital employed. And now, advantages is basically, first of all, it is very easily used and it is in line with ROC. Sir, ROC is for the company, ROI is for the particular project. So it is very easy to compare the divisions by each other by using ROI. And it is also a relative measure. Sir, I can compare percentage with percentage. One division is doing 10%, other division is doing 15%. I can compare these two with each other. So easy to compare. And it is also broken down into other ratios like profit margin, asset turnover, and all that ratios. You don't need to know about that much. We can split ROC into two different ratios. We call it as DuPont ratio analysis. You will learn that in FR and SBR. Okay, let's not worry about that. Next one, disadvantages, sir. First of all, dysfunctional decision making. What is dysfunctional? Lack of goal congruence is called dysfunctional. Lack of goal congruence is called dysfunctional. Okay. Lack of GC is called dysfunctional behavior. Okay. Next one. A division with a current ROI 30 would not accept a project ROI with 25, even if it is more than the current cost of capital. ROI increases with the age of the assets is the net book values are used. Sir, what is this line all about? This is what I told you. There is another explanation that needs to be given, but you are not covered that example or the question. So I did not teach that. Sir, the denominator is what? While calculating ROI, the denominator is what? Investment. Investment in what? Capital employed or the capital invested in what? In the assets of the company. What happens to the assets book value? What happens to the asset book value? Every year they come down by depreciation. Okay, sir, 1/2 versus 1/1, which is higher? Okay, let me put it this way, ma. If a company is having ROI of $10,000 every year, 10,000, 10,000, 10,000, every year I'm getting the same return, ma. But what happens to the denominator, sir? Depreciation, because of depreciation, assets value keep coming down. First year, 100,000. Suppose second year, every year depreciation is 20,000. Second year 80,000 it will be. Third year 60,000 it will be. So look at the ROI. First year 10%, second year 12.5%, third year 13.33%, 16.67%, 16.67%. Sorry, yeah, 16.67%. So your ROI is increasing every year without an actual increase in the profits. Profits remain the same because of the assets book value coming down. What is happening? Your company's ROI is increasing. This is the another problem with ROI, disadvantage of using ROI. Is that clear, everybody? Come on, fast. Again, we'll have to do transfer pricing also, ma. That's gonna take more time than this. Okay. Then coming to RI, we deduct the controllable profit minus the notional interest as well, ma. So notional interest, what we'll do, that is the cost of capital, basically weighted average cost of capital of your company. Advantages, sir, it encourages to invest in the decision, invest in the projects that give you positive RI or else positive NPV projects, even though they are less than the divisional's existing ROI. Making a specific charge for the interest will help better investment control, and also different rates of interest could be used. When we are calculating this 8% in the previous question, see, I gave you example, cost of capital is 8%. That includes debt, equity, and everything, ma. Weighted average cost of capital, which you'll learn in F9, financial management. Disadvantage is that it does not allow comparison between two entities. Sir, ROI of 10,000 cannot be compared with ROI of 15,000. Why? Because it is a number, not a percentage. You can only compare relative values. You can never compare absolute values. So 10,000 RA is with investment of 100,000. 15,000 RA is with investment of 500,000. Now tell me which is better. You cannot compare 10,000 with 15,000. What are the capitals invested? That also should be considered. So comparison becomes difficult if you are using RI. And also it is dependent upon the accounting profit. Accounting profits can be easily manipulated, right? Chalo, they give you another question. Blah, 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 blah. Comparison. Sir, so how do we compare different divisions while doing their performance evaluation? By using ROI, by using RI, by using variance analysis. Sir, what is variance analysis? We'll do in chapter 12. Okay, so basically variance analysis is budget versus actual. Okay, so one particular division, if you give them a target of 100, they are able to achieve 110. another division, we give them 100, they are able to achieve a target of 150. So now we can compare these two based on the variances as well. Based on different ratios analysis, ROC, ROI, GP, NP, all those ratios. Management ratios could be there. Sir, what are these management ratios? See, did you guys hear the word love per square foot or something? There is one web series, love per square feet or something like that. No, there is some web series that when I heard about that name of the web series, I was like, okay, this is something that I'm going to use in my classes. So there are certain calculations in business like revenue per square foot. Okay. So basically if your entity is spread across 10,000 square feet. So per square feet, how much revenue are you making? You don't watch web series. Good, sir. Keep it like that. Don't watch. They're a waste of time. But when you are not watching those web series, what are you doing? Are you investing that time somewhere which is productive, or are you wasting time in another type of thing? That's the only difference that you need to consider. You need to answer for yourself, sir. Don't answer for me. Now, coming to the next system, that is transfer pricing. How does a company determine its transfer price? That is what we are going to discuss in this particular topic now. Okay, so transfer pricing is basically within your internal divisions, at what price are we transferring? Now, while fixing the transfer price, we need to understand something. You may say, sir, anyway, that is also my division. This is also my division. Why should I have fund transfer between these divisions, sir? Actual money may or may not get transferred between the divisions. Please understand this very carefully. Actually, funds may or may not move between the divisions. It is depending upon hundreds of different reasons. Factors. Okay. So for example, if they are dependent divisions, that means head office only sends all the cash flows, sir. Whenever you need salary payment, head office will send the cash to you. So in that case, head office will not ask division A, you transfer money to division B. It will not say, because whether that money is with division A or division B, head office only will maintain everything. So in such cases, there won't be actual movement of cash, but still transfer pricing is required. Sir, why? You need to maintain the sales records. You need to maintain the stock reports. Sir, you transfer the goods to other division, but you are not recording in your books of accounts. What will happen? Your auditor will come and say that, sir, closing stock, you are showing 10,000. There is only 8,000 units. What happened to remaining 2,000? You're like, sir, we transferred to our other division. So what? Show it in the books of accounts. Now to show it in the books of accounts, at what rate shall I do the sale transaction? I should show that I have sold the goods, 2000 units. At what rate? Cost to cost? Okay. Which cost? Marginal cost, absorption cost, ABC cost, total cost, opportunity cost, market sales price. Which price am I supposed to take? So that is why transfer pricing is very much required for that. Okay. So what are the objectives of transfer pricing, sir? While setting a transfer price, keep the goal congruence in mind. We should not work towards, okay, division A should get more profit, division B should get more profit. No. Overall, company should have better objectives. Okay, that is the first point to be considered in mind. Okay, let me tell you a simple example, sir. Very simple example. Division A has some raw material. Okay, or else division A has one product which it can sell in the market for $30. Division A can sell in the market for $30. The same product is also used by division B in its production process. Whatever is sold by division A, division B is using in its production process as a raw material. Okay, sir. Happy, sir. But division B is buying from outside. Okay. Now you might ask, sir, why division B is buying from outside? Because whatever may be the reasons, they are buying from outside at $32. Division A is selling at 30. Division B is buying at 32. Sir, why? Because they are in different regions, ma. One is in south zone, other one is in north zone, different states or different countries, whatever may be the reason. Now, division B is talking to the head office and saying that, sir, see, we are buying for $32 in our market. Division A is only selling it for $30. If they are transferring it to us, we can save some cost. Okay. Now, company should think from the company's overall perspective. Division A may say that, no, I don't want to transfer to them. I want to sell in my market only. But It has to understand overall company's perspectives, ma. Okay, that is what goal congruence should be kept in mind. Then performance measurement. Based on the transfer pricing only, we are going to evaluate the performance of the respective divisions. So that should be kept in mind carefully. Okay. Next one, autonomy should be there. Sir, you should give us a little bit of decision-making power to the respective division managers. They should fix the transfer prices. If head office is fixing the transfer pricing, you cannot call it as controllable profits. And then it is important for recording the movement of goods. I already told you that. Now, how do we set the transfer pricing, sir? First technique is using the market-based approach. When we are fixing the transfer pricing, we can use market-based, or else we can transfer on the basis of cost to cost. Cost basis or market-based. If I'm doing it on market-based, based on the market prices, I will transfer the commodities or the goods or whatever services to the other division. See, market-based approach. If an external market exists for the transferred goods, then the transfer price could be set at the external market price. Could be. Need not be a rule. Maybe. It's an internal company policy. What are the advantages, sir? It becomes very easy to do the accounting, first of all. Second one, it is a fair approach, because whether you are selling to an external party or whether you are selling to internal division, you are selling at the same prices. So technically speaking, the selling division will be happy. They are like, okay, it doesn't matter whether I'm selling within the division or whether I'm selling outside the company. I'm getting the same price, so I'm happy. Okay. So these are the advantages. Transfer price should be deemed to be fair by the managers. Company's performance will not be impacted by setting a market-based approach, because whether you are selling within the company or outside the company, same prices. Whether you are buying within the company or outside the company, same prices. So it should not impact the company's overall policy at all. Okay, that is the first advantages of market-based approach. But disadvantage is that you cannot always find a market for all the products. Sometimes, you know, whatever division A is producing, it's only a raw material for division B. It cannot be sold in the market. So in that case, you don't know what is the external market price of that. Okay, next one. So do you know the external market price for Apple battery? I'm talking about the cost. You don't know. Okay, batteries at least we know, because they are being sold outside separately. But what about some elements which are not sold separately in the market? Unfortunately, I guess Apple, for all the smartphones, you can actually purchase units separately. Okay, that's a different story. But I guess you got the what I'm trying to tell, right? Some of the times your spare parts or the raw resources which you are using may not have an external market. You cannot find the sales price for that, market price for that. Okay. And the market prices keep fluctuating accordingly. Your transfer price also keeps fluctuating. Discounts need to be offered and all that stuff should be considered carefully. Now, sir, this is the most important thing. Please understand, this point is very, 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 very crucial. So pay attention here. What is this point, sir? You know, when you are transferring goods within your divisions, within your company, there are certain savings that you make. Taxes can be saved, because intra-group transfers, intra-company transfers are not taxable for GST, VAT or any other transfers for that matter. So you don't need to pay taxes on them. So you'll save that element. Packing, transportation cost, marketing charges. There are so many costs which you can save if you are doing within the division transfers. So what about those costs, sir? So when a company is setting a transfer price based on the market prices, it has to consider the cost savings that are being created as well. That is called adjusted market price, AMP, adjusted market price. Okay, we need to consider cost savings while determining the efficient or effective market price. See, savings may be made from transferring the goods internally, like delivery cost will be saved. This saving should be ideally deducted from the external market price while setting a transfer price. This will give you an adjusted market price. Now, coming to the cost-based approach, sir. So whatever is the cost incurred by the division, selling division, plus a profit, markup or margin added to that to determine the transfer price. Now, which cost shall I consider? I can consider full cost. I can consider marginal cost. I can consider opportunity cost as well. Any of these three costs can be considered. Sir, actually, standard cost can also be considered. Even standard cost can be considered. Okay. Okay, look at this. They just gave you some example here. Number of units transferred from division A to division B, 10,000 units. Material cost per unit is $8. Variable cost per unit is $2. Fixed costs are $60,000. Okay. See, recalculate the budgeted annual profit for each of the divisions and for the company A as a whole. if the transfer price for the component supplied from division A to division B is full cost plus 10%. Okay, sir, full cost plus 10%. Ma. Full cost is how much? $10 into 10,000 units, $100,000 plus fixed cost of 60, 160,000 divided by 10,000. That is $16 per unit is the total cost. Agreed? Or else I can directly say 60,000 by 10,000, that is $6 per unit. 8 plus 2, 10 plus 6, $16. That is the total cost. Plus 10%, that is 1.6. So the transfer price would be $17.6. Agreed, everybody? Now look at this. Okay, finished good is sold in the market for 35. Okay, that's fine. I don't worry about that. Next, the second case, they're asking you marginal cost plus 10%. What is the marginal cost? 8 plus 2, $10, $10 plus 10%. Only $11 I'll sell. Sir, that is very bad. If I'm selling at $11, na? If I'm selling at $11, will I be able to recover my fixed costs? Obviously, no. And not at all. I'm getting only $1 per unit towards the recovery of fixed cost. I'm selling 10,000 units. 10,000 I'll get. What about the remaining 50,000? I'm losing that. So division A will not agree for marginal cost plus 10% at all. It will not be able to recover its fixed costs. Okay, that is what they're trying to talk about. So they're asking you for the from the company's entire company's perspective and divisional perspectives. I guess this marginal cost plus 10% is going to give better profits for the overall company as a whole. But for division A, it is giving losses. That's why they are asking you very specifically that. I guess so. I'm not sure. Okay. Did everybody understand this question or do you want me to do it like step by step or something like that? I don't think it's necessary, but your wish, ma. If you ask, I'll do that. Okay, wonderful, sir. One after other, all kinds of good news these people are giving. Maldives is restricting Indian passenger. I mean, Indian. What do you call them? Travelers, visitors, whatever you want to call it. Maldives is completely blocking any Indian from entering into Maldives now. Nice, good, sir. Also, Goa is on complete lockdown from tomorrow. Please be careful, guys. Stay home, stay safe. As simple as that. Bahar mat jana. That's it. Only different questions are given. That's all. Nothing. Explanation is not given. Acha, nice. Cool. Okay, let's move on to the next chapter then. I thought previously there used to be questions on how to set the transfer price as well. What is the maximum price that the buying division is ready to purchase? What is the minimum price that the selling division is ready to sell? There used to be minimum selling price and maximum purchase price related discussions. I guess they removed it in PM and added it to APM. That's nice. Lucky you guys. It's there in APM though. I remember teaching in APM, like in the recent batch as well. Last chapter, chapter number 15, non-profit organizations. Woo! Chalo. After this, what do we have? We have variance analysis. That's the only chapter left after this. Amazing. Okay. Sir, all of you know non-for-profit organizations, right? Very good. We are able to finish the syllabus within the scheduled time, actually a little bit faster than that. So coming to your non-for-profit organizations, so what are these non-for-profit entities? Sir, non-for-profit entities are those entities which do not work for profit, as the name suggests. Very self-explanatory, sir. Sir, how clever are you to tell us that? Okay, jokes apart. So these profit not-for-profit entities, ma, please understand, the biggest misconception that the students have is that when we talk about not-for-profit, they think it is government entities. They think it is like government hospital, government schools, and all that stuff. No, my dear friends, that is one example of not-profit entities, ma. Even ACCA is a not-for-profit organization. Please understand, ACCA is a not-for-profit organization. Yes, if you want proof, I'll show you that. No problem at all. ACCA's mission and vision should have that. If I'm remembering it correctly, they clearly call themselves as a not-for-profit entity. Not covered here, but yeah, I remember they mention it in their exam fees proves it, sir. Not really, ma. Not really. Do you think your exam fees is high? If you think your examination fees is high, you should see CMA examination fee. It's 37,000, 38,000 per paper. Comparatively, yes, sir. Sir, I did CSCA, right? CSCA examination fees is 35,000 plus. You tell me if you think 10,000 per paper is high or less. 10,000, not 10,000, 12,500. It's approximately 12,500 or something. How much is CFA costing? I agree that there are only 2-3 papers in those things and you have 10 papers here. But then still, if you compare, na, total cost will come to overall that only, ma. Your overall total cost will come to that only. You don't need to think that you are paying too much for ACCA and comparatively other costs are less or other qualifications are not less, ma. Don't worry. CMA only 2 papers, so 35K is acceptable. Sir, what if you fail? It's acceptable, Kate. If you miss now, again 35K. Here, if you miss, 12,500. Secondary, yeah? Acha, whatever is out of your explanation, that's secondary. Very good, sir. Very good. Let me see. What is your total examination fee? 1,66,000 is your total examination fee throughout the course. Entire examination fee throughout the course is 1,66,000. You know, CFA costs you much higher than that. It costs you around 3 lakhs. So don't worry about it. That's fine. Anyways, let's not worry about it. But coming back to our discussions, not-for-profit organizations. So these are the entities which do not work for profit, ma. They work for the society's benefits. Now, best examples are your education, healthcare, or else your sanitation departments, your electricity provision by the central governments, and all that stuff, subsidies. All that stuff comes under the not-for-profit. Please understand, there are both private not-for-profit entities as well as public not-for-profit entities. Ma. Don't just think that always only public entities are not-for-profit. No, there are. ACC is a private body, but still it's a not-for-profit entity. So Sri Chaitanya Narayana call themselves as not-for-profit entities. Bhashyam is a not-for-profit entity. What are you talking about? They charge 50,000 for 7th standard, 6th standard kids. Plus IIT, 1 lakh per year. What nonsense are you saying about ACCA being very costly? Don't joke, ma. Okay. Anyways, so now how do we evaluate the performance of a not-for-profit entity, sir? If I say that, sir, I'll do GP ratio, NP ratio, people will come and slap me first of all. Are you mad or what? They're not working for profit. How are you comparing GP ratio, NP ratio? ROCE, ROI? How do you calculate return for a not-profitable entity? They're supplying for free there. How can you calculate their returns? I'm talking about charitable organizations, not your people who are collecting fees. Yes, for example, ACCA, yes, they do prepare profit and loss account. They do prepare profit and loss account, actually. Okay, for them, you can do GP ratio, NP ratio, but that is not the criteria. So their performances are evaluated based on other factors. How do we decide it is not for profit? Basis of determination. Okay, sir, there are two answers for this. One is based on the theoretical aspects, based on the conceptual aspects, and the other one is based on the legal factors, ma. Okay, So first of all, if I'm talking about conceptual factors based on the objectives of the company, based on the mission, vision, and their corporate goals, we determine whether a company is profitable or not for profit. Their mission statement clearly mentions that we are not working for profit. If I'm talking about an NPO, not profit organization. Whereas legally speaking, you have to get certain registrations. I guess form number 12B or something. It's been very long since I read relating to aspects relating to this. I guess it's been too long. I don't recall the form numbers, but it is form 12 or something. 12 or 12B. Form 12 is what? Declaration under income tax. License to engage in the business of imparting driving. No, not this. Something, I don't recall what is the form number. It's been so long. I'm so sorry. But yeah, you have to get an approval from the income tax department stating that, sir, we are not working for profits. We are only here as a charitable trust. And therefore, you will get that ATG certificates and all that stuff as well. You will get some deductions and all that stuff. So based on these two, you have to understand. Legally, if you are speaking, you should get the approval from the respective department. If you are talking about corporate conceptual clarity, then the mission statement says that we are not working for profits. Okay, coming back here. So as we are saying, a company which is not for profit entity, we cannot evaluate its performance based on the profit ratios, GP ratios, NP ratios, financial ratios, cost ratios, and all that nonsense. They are not working towards them. How can we decide if it's not? Okay, sir. Okay, good. Okay. So how do we evaluate them, sir? So if I'm asking about a school, okay, a school which is not for profit, how do you determine whether the school is efficiently working or not? How do you evaluate the performance of the school? Government school or else whatever school you're talking about, or else a hospital, any not-for-profit entity, any charitable organization, how do you determine their performances? Sir, for that we have a concept called VFM. Okay. Quality of service. Very good. Very good. But how do you measure quality then? That is the biggest problem. How do you measure the quality of a school? Come on, sir. Let's discuss. Let's not go into the subject. Let's discuss this example. I know how to finish the subject within the given time. Don't worry about it. You tell me, how do I determine the quality of service of a school? This is how our regular classes are. We talk and then the chapter completes automatically. You know, half of the time students know the answer for the entire chapter. They know the entire concepts. Only thing is faculty should know what correct question to ask the student. Automatically answers comes, the syllabus completes. Performance of the students. Okay. Can you give a student feedback and their results? Very good, Azim. Very good. So as you are saying, both are same. Performance of the students is determined by their results. Very good, sir. Now, is it right to say that performance of the students or the results of the students is the best metric for evaluating the faculty? Student is passing or failing doesn't mean the faculty is good or bad. I know the market is absolutely against this. I have seen faculties coming out and saying that we have international rank faculty, rank students, or else a global rank, national rank. Our students are doing this. Our students are doing that. Okay. I have an open challenge to those faculties. Tell me how many students enrolled with you for each subject and tell me how many of them passed. Ignore national rankers. Let's talk about the pass percentages then. That is the biggest problem. World sees only what you show them. That is the biggest problem with the student fraternity right now. Unfortunately, you guys fall prey for the marketing techniques of these kind of people. They market only the overall pass percentage. Yes, very good, ma. Thank you. That is a better metric. That is a better metric. Sir, why? Because you are talking about the entire population. You are not talking about a specific student's performances. You know, I'll tell you a very honest example. When we were in +1, +2, very cruel. This is very cruel, but this is how market functions. When we were in our +1, +2, na, first they conducted one entrance exam. Okay. After our 10th, they conducted one entrance exam. And based on the scores in that entrance exam, they split you into sections, which everybody know. Section A, B, C, or 1, 2, 3, alpha, beta, gamma, whatever it is, they do the sections. But the people, I'm not going to take the name of the institute, but you can easily find it out of from my resume or from my LinkedIn profile or anywhere. The college where I studied this plus one, plus two, they had tie up with two government colleges, and all the first section candidates, they register through their private name, our college name. The second, third, and fourth sections, they register the students on the government schools, government colleges names. You know why? 100% pass rate. Do you think any college has this 100% pass rate, sir? No. What they do is their last sections, they register on some other college's names. So if you take their certificates, if you take their inter-registration memos, which are not available to the students at all. Sir, I was my student, representative kind of a thing in our plus one, plus two. Not elected leader as such, but you know, those 5-6 students who are always very active, who have a good rapport with the faculties and the students, and communications and all. So I used to be a representative, basically. I used to be very close to my faculties and all. So I had access to some privileged content. So I know that I'm not disclosing my, I'm just stating that I'm not taking the name of the colleges and all. This is what every college does in India. That's a different story. So that's how they maintain 100% pass rate. All the lower sections of the students with average or below average scores, they register with different colleges names. And they say that all our students passed. Ghanta passed. This is what happens with the market. You guys only see what is being shown to you. What is behind the lines, what is between the lines is not shown to you. And you are not interested to know that also. Unfortunately. So let's not do that. If you tomorrow become a consultant for any company, don't just see the market metrics. Try to understand in between the lines. You know, efficiency levels are much different compared to effectiveness levels. So they are absolutely two different terms. Efficiency and effectiveness are absolutely two different terms. I can be 100% efficient, but may not be effective if I'm not putting in my efforts. Okay. So now let's move on to the topic of discussion here. So when we are talking about not-for-profit entities, we should not consider financial metrics. We should not consider variance analysis. We should not consider budgetary analysis. Then what are we supposed to consider, sir? How do I evaluate their performance? There is a tool called VFM, value for money, value for money. So what is this VFM, sir? It talks about three E's: efficiency, effectiveness, economy, efficiency, and effectiveness. Sir, what are the three words? Economy, efficiency, and effectiveness. Now, talking about economy. So cost calculation. So these are the numerics. Obviously, even though you are not working for profit, you still need revenues. You still need donations. You still have costs. You will still have, provisions to be maintained. Supplies to be done, transportation cost, all that stuff will be there. Financial metrics will still be there. Money should come in. Then only you can do donation. Then only you can do service. Without money, I cannot do services and all. Right? Common sense, ma. Common sense. Okay. Now, if I ask you to do a donation, you guys will be like, sir, what are you saying, sir? We don't have pocket money only. If you are working, then that's a different story. Even if you are working, I don't think you will have sufficient money to meet your expenses, meet your necessities, needs, wants, and then donations. I don't think you guys are making that much money, but touch wood, you guys will reach that point pretty soon with your hard work. Okay. Now, the cost efficiencies of the not-for-profit entities are determined by the economy levels. Okay. So basically, what were the last year donations? How much are the donations received current year? Are they increasing or decreasing? What are the services that we provided versus current year services that we are providing? If I'm talking about school, what is the cost per student last year, cost per student current year? Cost per faculty last year, cost per faculty current year. Like that, you have some metrics to be calculated. Then second E stands for efficiency. Third E stands for effectiveness. 90% of the students doesn't know the difference between efficiency and effectiveness. Let me talk about that in a very easy manner. Efficiency talks about the inputs that we give into the system. Effectiveness talks about the achievability of the outputs. Sir, what? Efficiency is how much you are putting into the system. Effectiveness is what is the result that is coming out. If I'm talking about a school, efficiency is determined by the faculty quality. Effectiveness is determined by the student passing the exam. These two are absolutely different terms, ma. A faculty can be 100% efficient, but if the student is not effectively working hard and if the student is not putting the pen on the paper in the exam hall, then he's not going to pass. We cannot say that this faculty is inefficient over there. Faculty is efficient. The school is efficient, but it is not effective in getting the results. Okay. Are you able to understand, sir, everybody? Good. My target is hit. I'm happy. Yes, sir. Okay, cool. Okay. So basically here, we talk about economy, cost, money related. Efficiency is input. How much input are we putting into the system? Effectiveness is how much is coming out. Okay, sir, let me tell you, when you're talking about a school, na? Thank you, sir. But you know, you are telling me that you guys should be effective to make me proud. Okay. I don't agree to that statement, sir, because of two factors. First factor is that your effectiveness is only determined for your result. If you pass the exam, you will get better results. You will get better money or whatever you want, respect, qualification, all that stuff you will get. I will get nothing. Very honestly, let's speak. I'll get nothing and I'm not expecting anything. And rather, I don't care about the students' effectiveness levels. I'm only worried about the students' efficiency levels. I know some students who are absolutely the best. Like any given day, I can bet my life that these people are going to be the gems of the country, but they might fail the examinations. Absolutely, yes. They failed. I have two examples right now with me. They are the best in the industry. I can proudly say they are very good. You know, one of the students, she scored 75 plus in PM with 7 days of training. 7 days. We finished the entire syllabus in 7 days. She scored 75 plus. Imagine the efficiency levels. She could not clear tax exam because of hundreds of different reasons, ma. Family pressures, corona issues, health issues. I know I have been through with her throughout her journey, so I know the pain she went through. She was ineffective. She was unable to clear the exam, not because she was inefficient. Because she had different factors, she was not effective. That's why I, as a faculty, I'm promising to all my students, I will never judge a student based on their effectiveness, whether they passed the exam or failed the exam. I don't care about the result at all. As long as you get the knowledge, na, I'm happy. As long as you go to an interview, sit in an interview and, you know, with raised collar, you can talk to the interviewer with confidence, stating that you ask me, I'll tell you. I know my worth. If you are there, I'm happy, ma. I don't care about you pass an exam or not. I don't really care at all. Okay, that is the first answer. Second thing is, after being 6 years in the teaching industry, I came to a conclusion that I should never determine my level or I should never judge my capability based on my students' performances. I came to a conclusion that I should never do that because what I can do, I know. I know my level, I know my worth. So I'm not going to judge it based on the how students are responding to that. There are students of mine who scored national ranks and international ranks also, sir. But I never did advertisement for that because that is their capability. The same paper, some other student might have failed. If I am really wonderful, everybody should get ranks. So it all depends on the students, nothing from the faculty. From my end, I should make sure that I am giving you 100% knowledge to the best of my capability. That's the end of discussion, as simple as that. So sir, I know your intention is honest and you meant well, but I'm sorry, I have to